Well, if you have your Bible this evening, I want to go into something that I've been thinking about and just a lot of conversation lately. Where do I want to start here? I've got quite a few references. I believe we went into this one the other day. John 17:17. I want to start out with that one. Just to establish, we're dealing with the Word of God and the church and how the Bible refers to the church as being the pillar and ground of the truth. The Bible referring to the Word of God as truth. The Bible referring to Jesus Christ as truth. And how in John 17:17, as Jesus was speaking to the Father, if you really want to read a prayer, the Lord's Prayer, Jesus praying, read John 17. It is the prayer of Jesus. Amen. And 26 verses long, Jesus praying to the Father. But he says in verse number 17, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. And we're in a generation, and I'm not trying to be mean, but I want you to think spiritually and biblically. If the Bible is truth, would you think about this statement? If the Bible, I'm going to throw the word Bible out and just trash it, okay? We're going to get rid of that word. We're going to say God's Word. Okay? Amen. If God's Word is truth, then what is anything that is, listen, contrary to it? That means opposed to it, opposite of it, speaking directly against it. What is it? What would you call it? An untrue. A lie. Deception. And we're in a generation, not, like I said, I'm not trying to be harsh or mean, but I get this comment a lot. Here's the statement I get. Preacher, you don't realize how hard the Bible is to understand. And I say, hey, now, I know where my mind is going, but I'm listening. I'm trying not to just listen to answer anymore. I'm trying not to. I'm trying to listen to find out what the person believes and where they're coming from, and not just to listen only for the sake of being able to get my point out. I'm trying not to. And as they say, you don't understand, my mind is saying, oh, I do understand. It's not the easiest book to understand. I understand that. I don't say that. I say, okay. And I get told over and over and over why people read the books that they read. The different Bible versions, the different things. And here's the statement. It's easier for me to understand. I read it because I don't like, and the one that everybody criticizes. You literally stack up every single Bible version in the world right here. You will get 99% of the preachers to say this. They're all good. They're all good. Except for one. That King James Version is too old, outdated, archaic, and hard to understand. That's the only one they literally trash and criticize. The only one. And I've done some reading and research. Was I having a conversation with you about Saul? Was it Saul? I was talking to somebody. Who was it? I was on the phone, I think, or with someone.
Who died?
With the age.
Yeah, I showed you that.
Yeah.
Samuel 13:1.
He brought up a verse. He's like, look at this. So I brought it up on my phone to check Bible versions. Man, there are some crazy things. I've done a little bit of research into some of these Bible versions. And it is getting crazier and crazier the more I read them. Yeah. They're making up names of plants. Yeah. They're making up names of animals. Bible, it talks about the tabernacle being covered with badger's skins. They say, that's either sea lion or walrus or seals. Well, the one that he pointed out the other day, I looked it up. It was talking about a length of time or how many years that Saul had reigned as king. Solomon.
Who's Saul?
Saul. That's what I thought, but for some reason my mind was saying Solomon afterwards. And it said in there, there's a couple numbers in there, and some Bible versions out there will say things like, when Saul was 2 years old, he began to reign. Well, they just change whatever numbers they want and turn him into a two-year-old king. And on, I'm looking at different versions, and I'm finding out that, as I mentioned the other day, about I was preaching, and I looked up a verse, and I looked at it to see, what do the other versions say about it? About Jezebel, the prophecy Jezebel was going to die by the wall. You remember me mentioning that the other day? And then later on, it says Jezebel was thrown out, and her blood splattered upon the wall. Well, a lot of our Bible versions out there says she died on a parcel of ground. Some of them say she died in a ditch. Some of them say she died out by, and it just gives all kinds of crazy answers. It can't be one or the other. Yes. I mean, it has to be one or the other. It can't be both of them. It can't be both.
Amen.
And as I'm studying, one I love to go to, the Bible says, a man that hath friends must show himself friendly.
Yeah,
that's right. A lot of the Bible versions out there say, a man that hath many friends is going to come to poverty. You can have too many friends and it'll lead to your ruin. That has nothing to do with a man that hath friends must show himself friendly. But as you start studying, they completely come from a counter point of view. And yet, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. And you have a book that calls itself the word of God, and you have a stack of books that call themselves the word of God, and they're constantly going contrary, something in there is wrong.
Dread.
And one I love to go to, I think it's in John chapter 7, where Jesus talks about going up, and he says, I go not up yet to this feast. A lot of Bible versions take the word yet out there, and Jesus says, I go not up to this feast. So the difference is, a few verses later, he goes to the feast a different way. So if he says, I go not up yet, and he sends the disciples, and then he goes up another way, he didn't lie to them. He said, I'm not going yet, you guys go on ahead, and then he goes around about and goes up later. But if he says, I go not up to this feast, and then he goes, that makes Jesus Christ a liar and therefore does not get to be my Savior.
That's right.
Because he's a liar. John chapter 7, verse 8. So as I start looking at a lot of this stuff, and I'm hearing this from a lot of different angles, it's easier to understand. There's some Bible verses that have gotten my attention lately. First of all, I want to go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And I'm reading this because this Bible passage right here has got my attention lately. A lot. We don't study the Bible to argue and fuss and fight with people. We don't study the Bible because we want to show people that we know more than them.
Amen.
We study the Word of God, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the Word of truth. Obviously, according to that verse, you are supposed to study the Word of God.
Amen.
If it has to be studied, then what? It's not easy.
Right.
I want it easy to understand. Why? So you don't have to study. The Bible says study. Study the Scriptures. You say, I just want it so simple. I don't want to have to do any work. Well, first of all, with that mentality, you're going contrary to what the Scriptures teach you to study, to work. And as I looked at this many times over the last couple weeks, this scripture has given me the thought. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, the Bible says this. Verse number 7. God hath not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness. He therefore that despiseth not man, but God, who hath also given unto us his Holy Spirit. But as touching brotherly love, ye need not that I write unto you, for ye yourselves are taught of God to love one another. That start right there got my attention. And that there's a lot of things that you and I need to be taught from the Word of God, whether in our own personal study and Bible reading, or from the pulpit, or from just fellowship with another brother or sister who says, hey, this is what I learned in the Scriptures, and I want to show you and encourage you and teach you something. The Bible says there's one thing that you don't have to be taught. If the Holy Spirit's in you and you're a believer, to love the brethren.
Amen.
You ought to have it naturally in you to love the brethren, those that are followers of Christ. They're family. But Paul says, I shouldn't have to be teaching you that. That's something that literally is of God. You see somebody that claims to be a believer but always at odds and always fighting God's people, something warns you. Step back and analyze the situation. Because there ought to be a brotherly love, a love for the people of God in there. That's natural and of God. Verse 10, and indeed ye do it toward all the brethren which are in all Macedonia. It's not even the people just in your church. He says, you guys have the love for the brethren all over the nation.
Amen.
I mean, you find out they're a brother in Christ, you just show that you love them and you care about them. It's just natural that God puts in you when you become His. Holy Spirit's in you. He says, but we beseech you, brethren, that ye increase more and more, verse number 11, and that ye study to be quiet and to do your own business and to work with your own hands as we commanded you, that ye may walk honestly toward them that are without, and ye may have lack of nothing. To study the Scriptures, to study righteousness and holiness. Why? For the purpose of being quiet. Now that doesn't mean that we're not supposed to be a witness and a testimony. But we're not supposed to be belligerent, hateful individuals trying to shove the Bible down somebody's throat. You know what we're supposed to be studying first? To live a godly life. How many people study the Word of God to tell somebody else how to live their life? Whoa, the Bible first should be studied so that I would study the Word of God and step back and learn how to live my life.
Amen.
And then in the process, I can be a blessing to another and show them what the Bible teaches.
Amen.
How many of we're just like that story? The one that's trying to get the mote out of someone else's eye while we got a beam in our own? We study the Word of God so that we can tell somebody else how it ought to be. We ever been guilty of that? Yep. Lord, forgive us. Sometimes we ought to learn to study so that it will shut us up. Look at ourselves in light of who we are, in light of who Christ is. Say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Not using the Bible to beat or berate people, but to love others. And then when you study, do your own business, work with your own hands. We're going to go here, 1 Corinthians chapter 2. The more you study the Scriptures, the more you learn the words of God, the more you understand what the Bible teaches, then you understand this. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Verse number 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. It says, but as it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God. Those that have trusted Jesus Christ as their Savior have the Spirit of God that comes and lives in their life, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. Which things also we speak, verse 13, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. That means, and I'm going to take this out of context, but at the same time it means not taking things out of context. It means taking scripture and scripture and scripture and comparing scripture and scripture and scripture and scripture. The Holy Spirit doing that.
Amen.
Verse 14, the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. Why do we need to make the Bible simpler, easier to understand? Because our flesh cannot understand God's word.
Amen.
And if we have not the Spirit of God giving us understanding and showing us as we, over time, as we read and we study, the Bible says to study. If the Spirit's not speaking to us because we don't have Him, then we really need it dumbed down for us. Because if you can't understand the Word of God, and I'm not saying in its entirety immediately, but if you cannot understand the Word of God through the Holy Spirit over time, showing you from scripture after scripture that you read, hey, this is what I mean. What is it, 1 John 5:13? These things have I written unto you that believe in the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life. Take the time to read the scriptures. He will verify and guarantee His promises time and again to you. He guarantees it. But if you get up and you sit and listen to a man preach and he says, you really can't know where you're going to spend eternity. You got to say this many prayers and you got to do penance and you got to show up this many and you got to take this cracker and wine and you got to, and maybe if you're good enough and if your family gives $1 million for the next 20 years, you get to go to heaven. And say that. He says, I wrote this so that you can know for sure that you have eternal life. How do you know that? Because the Spirit bears witness with our spirit, and He shows as we study the scriptures. God doesn't need His word dumbed down. He doesn't need it easier to understand. He needs you and I. Remember what we read from David? Was it the other day? And I told you I was listening to a preacher, and he read a verse in Psalm, I think it was Psalm 119, 18. No. Yes. Psalm 119, 18. He said, open thou mine eyes, that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law. What? When you go to the Word of God, it's not a game, it's a study. It's work. It's effort. Just like David, Lord, this is your word. I'm studying under your leadership, under your guidance. Please open my eyes and let me see what you have for me. It's not just a storybook. It's not just a history book. It's not just a book of poetic English. It's God's Word.
Amen.
It must be studied. And it must be through the discernment, as it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, of the Holy Spirit. Because without Him, we are spiritually discerned. We cannot understand. And we need it dumbed down. They have so many Reader's Digest version. You know, I'm not against children having Bible story books.
Right.
I'm not. But I don't call it the Bible.
Amen.
Because there's a lot missing out of it. I'm going to go one more passage and I'll be done. Matthew chapter 7. Let's go to Matthew chapter 7. is what I want to say to you and I and this in this generation. We have to be wise as serpents, harmless as doves. But we've got to be wise. In Matthew chapter 7, I just dealt with this a few minutes ago about the hypocrite casting the beam out, and then so you can see clearly cast the mote out. Verse number six, give not that which is holy unto the dogs. Neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn again and rend you. Truth is, there's so many wonderful things that the Bible teaches. So many wonderful things. You can take a lost person that doesn't know Jesus Christ, and you can tell them all kinds of things. They're not going to understand what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Because it's truly not for them.
That's right.
To let them know Jesus Christ as their Savior. They don't get to understand everything. Say, it's just words. It's just a book. You know what? The truth is, I don't completely understand it in my human understanding either.
Right.
I would think in my understanding, in my mentality, I would think some of the greatest minds in the world should be able to take that book and sit down and read it and understand it better than a child. But at the same time, I've seen a child sit down and read a few verses and just in amazement come over them and what they just realized the Bible taught. And the intellectual sit there and say, oh, I didn't see that. Why? Because the heart was different. One was looking at it from a child's point of view. Open now mine eyes. What does the Bible say? And one is, I'm going to speak. I'm going to prove that this means that I'm going to figure, I'm going to analyze. God says, through the discernment of the Holy Spirit, the discernment in the teaching and leading of the Holy Spirit, study to show thyself approved unto God. So as we live our life, let's not take our Bible reading as a joke, a game, or I'll be honest with you, as many have been taught in churches, as just a Bible reading program. Read your Bible through in a year. Can I tell you this? I've tore up a lot of read your Bible through programs in a year in my lifetime. I'd start them. I never finished one in that program. I never did. I couldn't do it. Now, have I read the Bible through? Absolutely. But sometimes you just get into something because it's a program that's recommended, and we don't do it because we really want to understand and study God's Word. We don't want to understand, find out what God has for us. It is a spiritual book. It is God's Word to God's people. Individually, God's Word to you. Collectively, it is God's Word also to the churches and how they ought to act and behave. To a lost person, it's not to them. And so, do I think there is a place in this world for versions that are contrary to the Word of God and dumbed down? Obviously there is. But in the life of a believer, it ought to be the desire to study, make it a hard work habit. A hard work habit. To actually go in intentionally study with God as your tutor, the Holy Spirit as your teacher, saying, you sit and read, and the Holy Spirit saying, I will show you what the Word of God teaches. And of course, if you study the Word of God, you know the Holy Spirit's going to do what? He's going to point you to Jesus.
Right.
He's going to point you to Jesus over and over.
Yeah.
And He's going to reveal Himself throughout chapter after book. Don't take the Bible as just a nice book. Be a hard worker. Study. Let God speak to you personally.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, I pray as we prepare to dismiss. Lord, I can't stand up here and preach a message like this only to give the people an understanding or a thought that I personally have the greatest Bible study habits, that I'm the greatest student of the Word of God, because if any of them were honest with themselves and with the understanding of mankind, they'd all know that that would be a big old joke. Or I'm not perfect, I'm human. There's days that I sit down and I read, and I don't ask for insight or wisdom, and yet still, somehow, you say, hey, I know you didn't pray and ask for it, but I still want you to learn something today. And Lord, you get my attention, and I have to come and apologize for my careless attitude and lack of desire to do any studying. I'm just reading for the sake of reading. Lord, I have to ask for forgiveness. Because time and again, in reading your word, you do reveal your truths over and over. Lord, I pray that you would help me not to be one who finally gets to a point in life where I say, I just need it easier to understand. I don't want to have to study anymore. I'll be okay with someone else just rewriting it for me. Lord, help us not to get that way. Lord, I'm not trying to be mean to anybody except our flesh. Forgive us where we let our flesh take over. May we study the Word of God in its entirety as often as we can. May we give you all the praise, honor, and glory for the things that we learn. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.
Amen.